Hare Krishna, Dandavats to everyone. So, previous class we have seen about Prema Bhakti. The class before that we saw about Bhava Bhakti. So, today we will be covering verse number 38, 38 and 39. We'll do two verses. Hopefully, we finish in 1 hour. I'll read the verse and then we'll do the prayers and we can start. Brahma Samhita verse 538. Very, very famous verse. I think everyone knows this verse. Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santas Sadaiva Hridayeshu Vilokayanti Yam Shama Sundaram Achintya Gunasvarupam Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Prema of love, Anjana, with salve, churita, tinged, bhakti of devotion, vilochanena, with the eye, santaha, the pure devotees, sada, always, eva, indeed, hridayeshu, in their hearts, vilokayanti, see, yam, whom, shyama, dark blue, sundaram, beautiful, achintya, inconceivable, guna, with attributes, swarupam, whose nature is endowed, govindam, govinda, adipurusham, the original person, tam, him, aham, I, bhajami, worship. Translation: I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who is Shyama Sundara, Krishna himself, with inconceivable, innumerable attributes, whom the pure devotees see in their heart of hearts with the eye of devotion, tinged with the salve of love. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjanashalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Girim Yatkrapatamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam Namamo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shri Mate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminitanamne Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschayati Deshtarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So today is verse 38, and many of you must have heard this verse, Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena. Devotees who are decorated with the salve of love or ointment of love can actually, whose eyes are decorated with the salve of love, can actually see Krishna. So in verse number 36, that is two verses before this, we saw Bhava Bhakti. So at the stage of Bhava Bhakti, there is some indication of a person's relationship with Krishna. But however, further details are not yet revealed. Then in verse number 37, we saw a little bit about Prema Bhakti. So in the stage of Prema, everything is completely manifest. And also we discuss the relationship between Radha and Krishna and the Sakhis of the spiritual world. And we also discussed a little bit about the spiritual world. So verse number 38 is actually a continuation of the previous two verses, and it says that how one can see Krishna at such an elevated state. So the previous two verses talk about a very high stage of bhakti, and verse number 38 says how they can actually see Krishna in such a stage. What happens? How are they getting the vision of Krishna? So this is again a little esoteric, but it's very nice to hear how a person is able to see Krishna at this stage. So if you see the purport given by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, it begins off by saying, the Shyama Sundara form of Krishna in his inconceivable, simultaneous, personal and impersonal, self-contradictory form. So that means what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is trying to say is that Krishna has both personal and impersonal aspects, and actually both are the same. So that means the explanation is that Krishna is not a temporary personal or an eternally impersonal form. He is eternally personal and simultaneously impersonal in his Brahmajyoti feature. He's eternally personal in his Bhagavan feature, and simultaneously he is impersonal in his Brahmajyoti feature. Both coexist together. So it doesn't mean that he's only impersonal. He also has a personal form. So just like, but and both are actually one single entity. That is what this first sentence by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is trying to indicate. So the analogy is given like the moon and the halo. So if you look at the moon and you see the halo around it in the night, actually the moon and the halo is actually considered as a single entity. So the halo is compared to the Brahmajyoti, and the moon is compared to Krishna. So what they're trying to say here is that this Brahmajyoti is like the halo of Krishna. So Krishna includes this halo. Okay, Krishna includes this halo. But the actual person Krishna is important more than the halo. That is the focus of this verse. Just like, for Krishna, like his body and he are non-different. For us, we have this body. Our body and soul are different from each other. But for Krishna, he and his form are the same. So he in his Brahman feature or Paramatma feature or Bhagavan feature is actually, it looks like it's contradicting in the sense they are totally different. But he's actually the same Bhagavan, has got both the Brahman and the Paramatma feature. Actually, all the three coexist is what this first sentence says. So, but however, our focus is on the personal form. We are not so much interested on the halo of Krishna, or though it is a part of Krishna, our focus is actually the person Krishna where we are trying to reach or we are trying to be with. So therefore, in the purport, Krishna is described as Shyamasundar, like a monsoon cloud. Then he is described as Natabara, the great dancer. He is described as Muralidhara, the person holding the flute. Tribhanga, standing in a threefold bending form. So these characteristics cannot refer to something impersonal. It clearly states that this is a person, but the other attributes are simultaneously there, but still the main aspect is actually his personal form. Because how can you have love for something that is just a light, right? You can have love for a person. How can you have love for something that is just a bright white light? So that's not possible. So the complete Bhagavan feature is actually described in this verse. The form of the Lord is not a mental concoction, but this form of the Lord is appreciated. The actual Bhagavan form of the Lord can be appreciated only by people whose eyes are imbued with devotion. So Krishna cannot be known by our mundane senses. So that is what the first half of the purport is trying to assert again and again. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is trying to tell us that Krishna has all these forms, yes, but the personal form is so important because that is the actual Krishna. And a person whose eyes is tinged with the love of devotion can actually see Krishna as he is, as the Bhagavan feature. And this Bhagavan cannot be conceived just by our mundane senses. Unless one comes to the platform of pure love, he cannot see Krishna as he is. So there is a very beautiful verse. This verse actually occurs in the Padma Purana, and it also is penned down in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu by Rupa Goswami. So if you see that verse, it's very interesting. It says, Adha Shri Krishna Namadi Na Bhaved Grahya Mindriyaihi Sevon Mukhe Hijahvadu Swayam Mevas Purati Adha. No one can understand the transcendental nature of the name, form, quality and pastimes of Krishna through his materially contaminated senses. Only when one becomes spiritually saturated by transcendental service to the Lord are the transcendental name, form, quality and pastimes of the Lord revealed to him. So one has to be spiritually saturated by transcendental service to the Lord. Only then everything is revealed to us. Just by our mundane senses, with our blunt material senses, we cannot see Krishna or understand Krishna. So we have to purify these senses with pure devotion. So actually when Krishna appeared in this world 5,000 years ago, so many people, they saw Krishna. They saw him with their material senses. but they did not appreciate him. Just like when we all go to the temple, we theoretically, yes, we know this is the deity. The deity is non-different from Krishna, right? But when we go to the temple and we see the deity, we are actually seeing it as this, as a stone. Are we really seeing it as Krishna standing in front of us? Theoretically, we know it. But practically, when we go there, are we really thinking that we are seeing Krishna? Actually, Krishna has come. He's here. This is the spiritual world and this is the Supreme Personality of Godhead in front of us. No, that doesn't happen. Because we are just seeing, trying to see Krishna with our material senses, with our material eyes. So we see only the stone and we bow down. Just because we know it theoretically, that's all. But actually, practically, we are not able to see that Krishna standing in front of us. Unless we have reached the transcendental state of pure devotional service. So, when Krishna came 5,000 years ago, some could understand him, as the Supreme Lord, but many of them couldn't understand who he was. So just like Hiranyakashipu, when Narasingadev appeared in front of him, he thought, wow, this is a superhuman beast who has appeared in front of me. Ravana thought that the Lord was a superhuman being. Sishupala, he was just chanting the names of Krishna, but still he was just thinking this is just another cowherd boy. And he was looking at him with full envy. So like this, the real revelation of the Lord is not there, even though you're able to perceive him with your blunt material senses. But however, the residents of Vrindavan, they were at the stage where they could go beyond all these perceiving the Lord through blunt material senses, because they had pure devotional service, and they could see Krishna as not only God, but beyond that, they could see Krishna as being theirs. That is the highest state. Just appreciation for Krishna as God is good, but beyond that, they went a step beyond that, and they felt Krishna as being their own. So when Krishna manifested himself in Vrindavan, both devotees and non-devotees saw him with the same very eye. But only the devotees cherished him as the jewel of their heart. So nowadays, even the devotees today, they are able to see Krishna. Like we were discussing some days back about Prakata and Aprakata Leela, how devotees are able to directly see the Aprakata Leela of Krishna. Why? Because they are saturated with devotion. They just don't see him with their blunt material eyes. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati writes that that the eye of the devotion is nothing but the eye of the pure, unalloyed spiritual self of the jiva. So that means that the pure state, the jiva is able to see Krishna as he is. Now if you see in the Srimad Bhagavatam, there are many descriptions of how different people saw Krishna and perceived in different ways. Like for example, in Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 43 chapter, verse 17, when Krishna came to Mathura, when he was fighting with Mushtika Chanura and Kuvaliya Pida, at that time there is a very beautiful verse in Srimad Bhagavatam. So that says, the various groups of people in the arena regarded Krishna in different ways when he entered it with his elder brother. The wrestler saw Krishna as a lightning bolt, the men of Mathura as the best of the males, the women as Cupid in person, the cowherd men as their relative, the impious rulers as a chastiser, his parents as their child, the king of the Bojas as death, the unintelligent as the Supreme Lord's universal form, the yogis as the absolute truth, and the Vrishnis as their supreme worshipable deity. So you see, based on the level of consciousness, each person saw Krishna in a different way. So when, with devotion, a neophyte devotee reaches the stage of Bhava Bhakti, at that time, the pure eye of, the eye of that devotee becomes tinged with the salve of love, and by the grace of Krishna, he is able to see Krishna face to face. That's why the phrase, in their hearts, is used. That means Krishna is visible in proportion as their hearts are purified by the practice of devotion, and when they, one first step is purifying our hearts and eyes with devotion. Second step is receiving Krishna's mercy. So when these two come along, that's when we actually see Krishna as he is face to face. So actually, I wanted to read some verses that is very interesting about how a person begins to see Krishna. And what happens to them when they see Krishna, when they reach the stage of Bhava Bhakti. So actually, even in the purport, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati has chosen to quote Bhagavatam 174. He quotes this verse, Bhakti Yogena Manasi. That means it is a state of how Vyasa Deva actually saw Krishna in his meditation. So this is the verse that Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati quotes. This is actually from the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And many of you must be remembering this verse. It is the story of how Vyasadeva initially, he was in a very confused state. And then Narada Muni came and advised him. And then he sat again in meditation and he could see the Lord. So that verse is very, very, very beautiful. That just shows how at a very elevated stage, Vyasadeva could actually see Krishna. So I'll read that verse in English. Thus he fixed his mind perfectly, engaging it by linking it in devotional service, bhakti yoga, without any tinge of materialism, and thus he saw the absolute personality of Godhead with his external energy, which was fully under control. So according to Narada Muni's vision, only when he was perfectly engaging in devotional service without any tinge of materialism, at that transcendental state, he could see the supreme personality of Godhead with his external energy fully under control. So the vision of Vyasadeva is actually one example of how a person is able to see Krishna directly. Now, he continues, Narada Muni, actually, this is another example that is in Bhagavatam, the first canto, when Narada is saying his story of how he goes through, his previous birth, how he was the son of a maid servant and all that. So in that story, he says about his final stages when he began to meditate on the form of the Lord. So if you see Bhagavatam 1:6:16, Narada Muni says, as soon as I began to meditate upon the lotus feet of the personality of Godhead with my mind transformed in transcendental love, the keyword is with my mind transformed in transcendental love, tears rolled down my eyes, and without delay, the Supreme Personality of God, Sri Krishna, appeared on the lotus of my heart. So, it is significant here that after he attained the stage of Bhava, there was a taste and attraction for, and he had unalloyed love. So, this verse talks about that. When his mind was transformed in transcendental love, that's when he saw the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Then in the very next verse, Narada Muni says, O Vyasadeva, at that time, being exceedingly overpowered by feelings of happiness, every part of my body became separately enlivened. Being absorbed in an ocean of ecstasy, I could see both myself and the Lord. So he said at the stage of Bhava Bhakti, when his senses were purified, he was in a transcendental state of devotional service, and the mercy of the Lord had descended on him, he could see the Supreme Lord. And when he saw the Supreme Lord, what happened is that he was overpowered by feelings of happiness. Every part of his body became separately enlivened. So this is very interesting. And in Madhurya Kadambini, actually Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, if I'm not wrong, has written Madhurya Kadambini, and there it explains, actually there are some interesting notes on how each sense of a person becomes enlivened at this stage. So it gives two explanations. One, at the stage of Bhava Bhakti, how a person feels, okay, what happens to him, how each sense is enlivened, and at the stage of Prema Bhakti, how again these senses are even further enlivened. So I'll read some excerpts from that. It's very interesting. It says, centered by the fragrance of Bhava, all the emotions of the heart become like oil of liquefied bunches of sesame seeds, and at once fit to smear on the limbs of the Lord. At the appearance of Bhava, even a chandala becomes worthy of respect from Lord Brahma and others. At that time, a person's eyes fully long to turn towards Vrajendra Nandana, to lick the blackness of his limbs, the rosy hue of his lips and eye rims, the white brilliance of his moon-like teeth shining in a smiling face, and the yellow hue of his clothing and ornaments. Then they begin to bathe his body in profuse streams of tears. So you see, first, their tongue is enlivened. They feel like licking the Lord. Actually, this is what happens at the stage of Bhava. How each sense organ gets enlivened is what they are saying. So they want to lick the Lord, his blackish complexion. Then they begin to bathe his body in profuse streams of tears, like he is running here and there, freezing its motion at every moment and raising his ears. The ears get enlivened. They start raising their ears. This person longs for his ears to be decorated with the earrings of the song of Krishna's flute, the jingling of his anklets, and the sweet intonation of his voice, almost like a direct order to serve his lotus feet. Then thinking how he longed for the touch of the Lord's tender hands, his body erupts in ecstasy. That is, his skin erupts in ecstasy. So his eyes are enlivened, tongue is enlivened, eyes is enlivened. Now his entire body starts erupting in ecstasy. His nostrils open wide, and repeatedly he inhales, and he examines the fragrance of the Lord's body. Oh, will I ever be able to taste the nectar of his lips? Feeling like this, and feeling that he has attained the taste, his tongue feels great joy and he licks his lips. Sometimes feeling like he has obtained direct realization of the God in his heart, he feels unlimited happiness in his mind. Tasting the rare treasure of the sweetness of the Lord, he becomes delirious. Then at the disappearance of that feeling, he plunges into grief. In this way, it is like he is decorating his body with 33 symptoms of Sanchari Bhav. So this is what happens at the stage of Bhava Bhakti, especially when a person gets the vision of the Lord. All these senses are enlivened. He feels like licking. His eyes are crying. He has tears rolling down. His eyes are perking up. His ears are perking up. And then his entire skin erupts in ecstasy. So his nostrils are wide open. He's trying to get the fragrance of the Lord. He has seen all these, each and every sense organ is enlivened. And then finally, when the Lord disappears, he plunges into grief. So this is what happens at the stage of Bhava Bhakti. Now the same emotions at the stage of Prema Bhakti is discussed. How each sense organ is actually enlivened at the stage of Prema Bhakti. So this all happened to Narada Muni. I just read the verse of Narada Muni from Bhagavatam, how he felt. So the same thing is actually further described in Madhurya Kadambini. Actually, every devotee at the stage of Bhava Bhakti goes through all these symptoms. So at the stage of Prema, what happens? When the Lord reveals his beauty, Saundarya, to the eyes of the devotee, on account of the sweetness of that beauty, all the senses and the mind take on the quality of the eyes, and obstacles such as paralysis, shaking, and tears are generated. From this, the devotee swoons in bliss. To console the devotee, the Lord next reveals his fragrance to the nostrils of the devotee, and all the devotee's senses take on the quality of the nose to smell. Again, the devotee swoons in bliss. Then the Lord reveals his sonorous voice to the devotee's ears. Oh, my devotee, I am under your control. Don't be overwhelmed, but fully satisfy your desire by relishing me. All the senses become like the ears to hear, and for the third time, the devotee faints. At the beginning of the swoon, the Lord then mercifully gives the touch of his lotus feet, his hands, his breast to the devotee, and reveals his fresh youthfulness, Saukumarya, to the devotee. To those in the mood of servitude, he bestows his lotus feet on their heads. To those in the mood of friendship, he grasps their hands with his. For those in the mood of parental affection, he wipes away their tears with his own hands. And for those in conjugal mood, he awards them with their embrace, touching them with his hands and chest. Then the devotees' senses all take on the sense of touch, and the devotee faints for the fourth time in a deep swoon. At the start of the swoon, the Lord then restores him by giving a taste from his own lips. This, however, is revealed only to those in the conjugal mood. The devotee's senses take on the sense of taste and he faints for the fifth time. This blissful swoon is so deep that the Lord must revive him by bestowing his generosity, audarya. Audarya refers to a state in which simultaneously all of the Lord's qualities, his beauty, fragrance, sound, touch and taste suddenly manifest themselves to the devotee's various senses. So this is at the stage of prema, how each, very beautifully it's described how a devotee feels. Each and every sense organ actually takes charge of one by one. Supposing, like for example, it's a stage one, he's able to see the Lord with his eyes, right? That is stage one. So that means all the sense organs, they take on the role of the eyes at that time. So all the sense organs then take on the roles of the ears, then the nose, like that it goes. The feelings of the devotee is actually expressed here. And finally, how after each and every experience, the devotee faints, he swoons and faints, again he comes alive. Again he feels the next aspect of the Lord. Like that, in the stage of prema bhakti, which is the topmost, the devotee has these symptoms. So this is how a devotee in the stage of bhava and prema feel, and this is how they are seeing the Lord. With the Premanjana Churita. This is how they actually experience the Lord. So actually Krishna becomes revealed in the heart of the devotee whom the pure devotees see in their hearts tinged with devotion. So that is the meaning of this verse, Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena. Actually it's very interesting, when Prabhupada was here, Prabhupada was asked by a reporter, he was asked, have you seen God? So at that time Prabhupada, he paused for a moment and he asked the reporter, so if I tell you the answer, will you believe it? And then what can the reporter say? He nodded his head and he said, yeah, I will believe it if you tell the answer. And then Prabhupada said, yes, I've seen him. And I'm always seeing him. So this is the answer given by Srila Prabhupada. Now the reporter couldn't say anything because he committed first that he would believe Prabhupada. But that is very true. Actually, Prabhupada did see the Lord and he was in the stage. He had the vision of the Lord. Not only that, he was continuously seeing the Lord because love is not intermittent. It is actually a continuous process at this stage. So Prabhupada has also mentioned several times, externally I'm in different places. I may be in the US, I may be in UK, London, I may be in South Africa, I may be anywhere externally. But I'm always with Krishna. This is a statement that he always makes. He was continuously at the stage where he could see Krishna in front of him every time. So this is about this verse, how a devotee sees Krishna once he's elevated to such a state. So next we'll go to verse number 39. So till 38, 37, 36, these three verses actually go hand in hand because it shows different gradations, bhava, prema and how to see the Lord in that state. Now we'll go to verse number 39. So from verse number 39 onwards, it talks more about the majesty of Krishna. How Krishna is so great in the sense how he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So it begins off with verse number 39, which is another very interesting verse. And also there is so much interesting references for this, which we will go through. So I'll read the verse. Rama di murti shukala niyamena tishtam nana avataram akrod bhuvaneshu kintu Krishna swayam sambhavat paramah pumanyo Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Rama Adi, the incarnations of Lord Rama, etc. Murtishu, in different forms. Kalaniyamena, by the order of plenary portion. Tishtan, existing. Nana, various. Avataram, incarnations. Akrot, executed. Bhuvaneshu, within the worlds, kintu, but, Krishnaha, Lord Krishna, swayam, personally, sambhavat, appeared, paramaha, the supreme, puman, person, yah, who, govindam, govinda, adipurusham, the original person, tam, him, aham, I, bhajami, worship. Translation. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who manifested himself personally as Krishna and the different avatars in the world in the forms of Rama, Narasimha, Vamana, etc. as his subjective portions. So actually, this verse says that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the rest of the incarnations are actually his expansions. So this is one epic verse from the Brahma Samhita, which is very similar to the Ete Chamsa Kalapam Shakrishnastu Bhagavan Swayam, that verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is considered also as the one of the most important verses in Srimad Bhagavatam, Paribhasha Sutra. So purport also I will read, and then we'll do a long discussion on this purport. His subjective portions as the avatars, which is Rama, etc., appear from Vaikuntha, and his own form Krishna manifests himself with Vraja in this mood from Goloka. The underlying sense is that Krishna Chaitanya, identical with Krishna himself, also brings about by his appearance the direct manifestation of Godhead himself. So there are two sentences Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati talks here. So in the first sentence, he says that Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan and he comes from Goloka Vrindavan, and the rest of the incarnations are a subjective portions and they are coming from different parts of Vaikuntha. Okay, that is one thing that he mentions. The other thing he mentions is about Krishna Chaitanya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, however, is Krishna himself. He is not an expansion of Krishna. So that is something that has to be very clear. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not an expansion of Krishna. Whereas he is the same self, Krishna himself, who comes again. So these are the two points Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati has focused on. But we'll elaborate a little more on this verse because it's extremely interesting. And generally this is a topic that we come across quite often in our Krishna consciousness philosophy. So I'll just elaborate a bit on it, and many of you must be aware of this topic very well actually. So if you see in this verse, it says Swayam Sambhavat and Kala Niyamena. These two phrases are quite important. Kala means portion. Kala means time. Kala means portion. So Kala Niyamena, portion of plenary portion. Actually, this is the exact translation. Kala is a portion of a plenary portion. What does that mean? It means an expansion of an expansion. These Rama, Narasimha, Vamana, all of them are an expansion of an expansion, portion of a plenary portion. That means Krishna's expansion is Balaram. First expansion, if you see how Krishna expands himself to different forms, the very first form that he expands into is Balaram, and then his further expansion are the incarnations that we talk about. So we all know this, we have gone through this several times, like after Krishna it is Balaram, and from then Balaram he takes the Chaturvyuha, and then from the Chaturvyuha you have Narayana, then you have the second Chaturvyuha, then you have the three Vishnus, then from the three Vishnus you have the creation that begins, and further on whatever happens. So we know that it all begins with Balaram. So Balaram is the first expansion, and his further expansions are the remaining incarnations. So that's why it says Kala Niyamena. Okay, Niyamena means they have fixed powers or they rule. Okay, that's what Niyamena means. But Kala means portion of a portion. The second phrase that is used here is Swayam Sambhavat. Krishna is actually Swayam Bhagavan. Sambhavat means he appears himself in the world at different times. The same Swayam Bhagavan actually appears in the material realm in every day of Brahma. Krishna himself appears, Swayam Sambhavat. The same Krishna himself appears as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The same Krishna from Goloka Vrindavan, the Swayam Bhagavan, actually appears as Sri Krishna also, like he appeared 5,000 years ago. So this is what these two phrases actually mean. Now talking about the incarnations of the Lord, so we know, or the expansions of the Lord you can say, we all know that there are different types of incarnations. So there are six different types of incarnations. The first set is called as the Purushavataras. So the Purusha avatars are the Vishnus, Karanodakshay Vishnu, Garbhodakshay Vishnu, and Shirodakshay Vishnu. Then the Guna Avataras, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, we all know these three are Guna Avataras. Then you have Leela Avataras, the pastime avataras. Generally the Dasha Avatara is actually the most celebrated of the Leela Avatars, but there are about 25 you can find in the Srimad Bhagavatam of different Leela Avataras. So most of the incarnations are Leela Avataras. Leela Avatara means they come and perform pastime. So like that, if you see, most of Krishna's avataras are all Leela avataras. They come and perform pastimes. Then you have Manvantara avataras. So for each Manvantara, there is a particular incarnation of Krishna which is considered important. Okay, this incarnation is called as the Manvantara incarnation. Then there is Yuga avatara. For each Yuga, to establish the Yuga Dharma, a particular incarnation of the Lord descends. So that is called as Yuga Avatara. Just like in this Yuga, we are in the Kali Yuga of the 28th cycle of the Chatur Yuga of the day of Brahma, where we have Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as the Yuga Avatar. So this is a very special Kali Yuga, and we are very fortunate to be born at this particular time. That too after the appearance of Prabhupada, that too in the second generation devotees, because everything has been set for us. The stage has been set. We don't even have to go and work hard the way our previous generation did. So we are probably in the best of the situations. We appeared right after Krishna, right after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, right after Prabhupada, that too second generation. So everything is so easy for us. We are probably the most fortunate actually. So that is Yuga Avatara. For each Yuga, there is a particular personality who comes and spreads the Yuga Dharma. Okay, then you have Shakti Avesha Avataras, empowered incarnations. So I think we know about the Purusha Avatara, Guna Avatara, Leela Avatara, but I will say a little bit about Manvantara Avatara. So we all know that now the current Manu is Vaivasvata Manu. The name of why he is called Vaivasvata Manu is because he is the son of Vivaswan, who is the sun god. The son of Vivaswan is called as Vaivasvata. But actually he has another name. Actually his name is Shraddha Deva. His name is Shraddha Deva. He is also called as Vaivasvata because he is the son of Vivaswan. So the current Manu is he is the seventh Manu. Okay, in every Kalpa or a day of Brahma, there are 14 Manus. So currently we are in the 7th Manu period. So this person is Vaivasvata Manu. His father is Vivaswan. And the Manvantara avatara for this particular Manvantara is actually Vamanadev. Vamanadev is considered as the Manvantara avatara. And the Indra is Purandara. The current Indra who is ruling now in this Manvantara, his name is Purandara. His name is not Indra. Indra is a post. This particular Jiva's name is Purandara. Okay, so like that, for each Manu's period, there is a particular Manvantara avatara. So I'll read all the 14. It's interesting to hear their names because these are the names of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So in the first Manu, Swayambhuva Manu. We all remember from Bhagavatam. First Manu who was created by Brahma is Swayambhuva Manu. So Swayambhuva Manu, during the period of Swayambhuva Manu, the avatara is Yajna Avatara, the red incarnation, often he is called Yajna. Then Swarochisa Manu, Vibhu, the name of the Supreme Lord is Vibhu. Uttama Manu, the name of the Supreme Lord is Satyasena. Tamasa Manu, the name of the incarnation is Hari. Remember Hari, which pastime he comes? He comes in the Gajendra Moksha pastime. So the Lord who came and saved Gajendra, his name is Hari, Hari Bhagavan. So that Hari, he appeared in the period of Tamasamanu. So he is the Manvanta Avatara for Tamasamanu. Next, Raivatamanu, the incarnation's name is Vaikuntha. His name itself is Vaikuntha. Then in the Chakshushamanu, the Supreme Personality of Godhead's chief incarnation name is Ajita. So remember Ajita, he comes in the pastime of churning the milk ocean. So the person who after when the Devas and the Asuras were having a tough time, Ajita, Lord Ajita came and churned the milk ocean. So he appeared during the Chakshusha Manvantara. That is the previous Manvantara. Chakshusha was 6th Manvantara. So 7th is Vaivasvata Manvantara, and in our Manvantara, Vamanadeva appeared. Then in 8th, future, you want to hear, so I will tell the names of the future Manvantara incarnations of the Lord. 8th Manu, whose name is Savarani, the Lord's name will be Sarvabhauma. In the 9th Manu, whose name is Daksha Savarani, the Lord's name is Rishabha. 10th Manu, Brahma Savarani, the Lord's name is Vishvaksena. 11th Manu, Dharma Savarani, the Lord's name is Dharmasetu. Next Manu, Rudra Savarani, the Lord's name is Swadhama or Sudhama. 13th Manu, Deva Savarani, the Lord's name is Yogeshwara. 14th Manu, Indra Savarani, the Lord's name is Brihatbhanu. So these are the names of the Manvantara incarnations of all the 14 Manus of this Kalpa. Okay. Of these 14 Manvantara avatars that I named, Yajnadev appeared in Swayambhuva Manu's time, yeah. Swayambhuva Manu's time. His name, so Yajnadeva and Vamanadeva are also Leela avatars. They came and they performed Leelas. Vamanadeva Leela we read in Bhagavatam with reference to Bali Maharaj. So they are also Leela avatars, and all these 14 Manvantara avatars, they are also called as Vaibhava avatars. That is also the way they are referred as, Vaibhava avatars. Then in Srimad, so generally Manvantara avatars are confused with the Manus. But however, Manvantara avatars are the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So like we see that Vamana is the name of the Lord who appeared in the time of Vaivasvata Manu. So Vaivasvata Manu is the name of the Manu, and Vamana is the name of the incarnation called as the Manvantara incarnation. So that is about Manvantara avatars. Then I'll say a little bit about Shakti Avesha, because we all know Shakti Avesha means empowered incarnations. Now, Shakti Avesha avatars are actually of two kinds. They are direct and indirect. So when the Lord himself comes, he is called Sakshat, or a direct Shakti Avesha avatara. And when he empowers a jiva or a living entity to represent him, that living entity is called as indirect or Avesha incarnation. Okay. So there are two types. One is Sakshat avatara and another one is Shakti Avesha avatara. So Sakshat examples of the Supreme, it is actually the Supreme Lord himself, is the examples are Sesha and Ananta incarnations. So Sheshanag is actually the Lord, but it is actually Sakshat Avesha avatar. He's a Sakshat Avesha, Sesha and Ananta. Okay, both of them. In Ananta, the power of sustaining all planets is invested. What is the power that is invested is, in Ananta, the power of sustaining all the planets is invested. And in the Sesha incarnation, the power for serving the Supreme Lord is invested. Actually, both are actually an expansion of the Supreme Lord. But they are actually Avesha avataras. They are Sakshat Avesha avatar. Now, Shakti Avesha is different. Shakti Avesha means inside a particular jiva, a particular empowerment is given by the Lord. So a lot of indirect avataras are there. For example, the four Kumaras, Narada Muni, Prithu Maharaj, Parashurama, all of them are actually indirect avataras. That means they are actually Jiva Tattva, but they are empowered by the Lord. So like for example, in Prithu Maharaj, the ruling capacity, that was invested. Parashurama, we know how he conquered everybody. Like that, each one has a particular, or for example, Narada Muni, bhakti was the characteristic that was he was empowered with, like that. So a specific power is given to them by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So whenever a specific opulence of the Supreme Lord is invested in a particular entity, they are called as Avesha avataras. Four Kumaras, they specifically represent the Lord's opulence of knowledge. Narada represents devotional service. Then Brahma, he has the opulence of creating. Creating power is invested in him. He's also an empowered incarnation. He's also a guna avatar. So it's like some incarnations can fit into many categories. Similarly, Parashurama was invested with the power of killing the evil, like that. But there is another thing to do with Shakti Avesha. So we saw direct Sakshat, then we saw indirect, where there is a empowerment for a particular living entity. We saw two types. Now there is another type known as Vibhuti, or a special favor of the Supreme Lord is exhibited in a particular entity. That is also considered as a special favor by the Lord. When a particular person has extreme beauty, or when he is extremely popular, or when he becomes extremely rich or extremely powerful, he is known to be specially favored by the Lord, in the sense the Lord has blessed him with this opulence. So, for example, a flower, even a flower that is very beautiful, is actually a blessing by the Lord. So that is, in that sense, he's also actually received a special mercy of the Lord, right? So that is also empowerment by the Lord, you can say. So this has three varieties. Somebody who is extremely beautiful or extremely powerful, extremely rich, all this is actually a spark of what the Supreme Lord has, and the Lord has blessed him with that. Okay? So this is about the different incarnations. We have to go through the different incarnations. Now, however, all these incarnations are actually coming from Krishna, because the entire theme of the Srimad Bhagavatam is actually Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam. It's also the Parivasha Sutra. Similarly, here in this verse, it says Krishna is actually Swayam Sambhavat. It is actually Krishna who is Swayam Bhagavan. Again, in the Bhagavad Gita, you see Krishna is saying, even Brahmano hi Pratishtahim, even the Brahman actually comes from me, or the Brahma Jyoti is actually I am the basis of the Brahma Jyoti. That means everything actually is coming of me. Everything is a spark of my splendor. Like this, Krishna makes so many statements in the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavatam talks about it. The Brahma Samhita also talks about it. Now, at this point, I think we have another 10 minutes. So, I'll quickly read some important verses from Laghu Bhagavatamrita. Why I'm going to read this is that, if you see in this verse, it begins with Ramadi Murtishu. Now, at this point, why does it particularly say about Rama? Because Rama is also a complete incarnation. But however, he is not Swayam Bhagavan. There is a difference. Like, for example, Rama, when he came here, he was a very popular incarnation. Actually, there are many Rama Bhaktas. Similarly, Narsingadev also. He is a very, very important incarnation. Narsingadev, Rama, all of them are very, very important incarnations. But still, in the Laghu Bhagavatamrita, Rupa Goswami goes to prove how Krishna is actually, they are source also, and Krishna becomes superior to everybody. Now, this is not this is not a question of superior or inferior. It's more like to prove that Krishna is the source of everything. That's all. So, not to be taken in a comparable mood. Okay, so I'll just read this very interesting verses from Laghu Bhagavatamrita. This is actually part 1, chapter 5, text number 40 onwards. At this point, someone may ask whether Lord Narasimha and Lord Ramachandra are on an equal level with Krishna. To answer this question, let us review how the Vishnu Purana addresses this issue. In the part 4 of the Vishnu Purana, 4.15.1.2, Maitreya asks this question. After Vishnu killed Hiranyakashipu and later Ravana, the Jiva who had taken birth as these demons achieved facilities for material enjoyment even the demigods cannot attain. Why in those circumstances did he not achieve liberation of merging into the eternal Lord Hari as he did after he took the birth as Sishupala, who was killed by the Lord? So this question is asked by Maitreya Rishi. Why didn't Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu, Ravana, Kumbhakarna, why didn't they actually achieve liberation? But why did the same person have to take birth as Sishupala Dantavakra to actually attain liberation? This is the question asked by Maitreya Rishi. Okay, so the next verse says, Sri Parashara answered, to kill the king of the demons, he who is the creator, maintainer and destroyer of all the worlds, revealed his unparalleled form of Narasimha. At that time, Hiranyakashipu did not realize that Narasimha was Vishnu. thinking that this powerful being had accumulated heaps of extremely pious credits, Hiranyakashipu focused his attention on him under the strong impulsion of the mode of passion. By concentrating his mind on the Lord in this way, while the Lord killed him, in his next life, he attained the ten-headed Ravana life. Okay, Hiranyakashipu was only. When he became Ravana, Hiranyakashipu was only given facilities for material enjoyment that are unequaled in the three worlds. So when he was in the body of Hiranyakashipu and when he was fighting, he was in the mode of passion. He didn't take Narasimha very seriously. He just thought this is a fantastic beast, man come beast. So his consciousness was not in the right mode. Okay, hence. In the next life, he got the birth of Ravana, okay? And he was given very good facilities for material enjoyment that is unequaled in the three worlds. Because of Hiranyakashipu's bewilderment, his mind did not actually take shelter of and unite with the personality of Godhead, the Supreme Absolute Truth without beginning and end. Because of Hiranyakashipu's bewilderment, he was passionate and he was bewildered. Then in his next life as Ravana, what happened? Under the sway of Cupid, he became obsessed with Janaki. Thus, although he saw the Lord in his form as the son of Dasharath, he failed to become spiritually attracted to him or to realize. Here is the infallible Lord. Instead, he conceived of him as an ordinary human, and again he obtained the diminished results from dying in Lord Achyuta's hands. In the next birth, he took birth as Shishupal. So he was bewildered again in the mode of passion again, but here he was affected by lust because he wanted to take away Sita Devi. So again he couldn't understand the glory of the Supreme Lord, and he obtained only diminished results. So again he had to take birth as Shishupala. Okay, he was known as the, again he became world renowned, he took birth in a world renowned family in the king of Chedi, and he enjoyed unlimited power. So again the same person had to take birth. Now as Shishupala, he found the cause to chant the Supreme Lord's name with his mind absorbed incessantly in the Lord. After several lifetimes of hatred, he uttered all his names to criticize, scold, and otherwise abuse him. Whether Shishupala was walking, eating, bathing, sitting, sleeping, or doing anything else, his deep-seated envy caused his heart and mind to be inescapably absorbed in the image of the Lord's form. He saw that the Lord had eyes as perfectly beautiful as fully blossomed lotus petals, that he wore brilliantly effulgent yellow garment and a spotlessly beautiful helmet decorated his head, and that ornaments graced his four glorious stout arms with which he held conch, disc, club and lotus. So when Krishna appears as Swayam Rupa, he constantly manifests the specific potency of enchantment. So that the way he enchants the devotee actually leads to their liberation. So Shishupala was fully absorbed with his mind in Krishna. And when Krishna killed him with the Sudarshan disc, he attained liberation. So actually, when Krishna appears, the person becomes enchanted, totally enchanted. The same Krishna, when he appeared as Narasimha Dev or when he appeared as Lord Ramachandra, the opposition party was not so enchanted. Though Shishupala had so much envy, how was he enchanted? He was always enchanted by the name and the form. So constantly, he was actually chanting the name of Krishna, and he was actually meditating on the form of Krishna. So, in fact, this also happened to Kamsa. He was constantly remembering Krishna. So, why? Because Krishna is so enchanting. Even if a person is seeing him with envy, he's actually very, very enchanting. And it resulted in constant absorption of the Lord. So, that Shishupala called out to Krishna's name in anger and fixed with attention upon him. From the halo of the rays emanating from the disc, the Lord hurled to kill him. Shishupala could finally see that the personality of Godhead and the infallible brilliance of his personal form were the supreme absolute truth. Okay, so this is about the story of Shishupala and how he was actually, how Krishna actually attracted him. This is all to prove that Krishna is actually that supreme person, and he's got the most attractive power than any other incarnation. At that moment, the Supreme Lord quickly dispatched him, and all his accumulated sins were burned away by his remembering the Lord. The Lord finished Sishupala's material existence, and Sishupala merged into the Lord. All of Sishupala's sins were burnt away by the chanting of Krishna's names and meditating immensely on Krishna's form, even in hatred. Sishupala obtained prema and realized Krishna's actual position by value of the auspicious influence of Krishna's Sudarshan Chakra rushing towards him. In that moment, Sishupala acquired all the assets of spiritual practice, and so Krishna personally brought him close to his transcendental body. The liberation Sishupala attained was not impersonal merging, but connection with the Lord in personal service. The word laya means not only dissolution, merging with the Lord is considered to be a kind of dissolution, but also closeness, according to Haimakosha dictionary. Now I have explained the whole situation to you. Certainly, he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Upon those who describe and remember him, even in the mood of hatred, he bestows a fruit rarely obtained by demigods, asuras, and other superhuman beings. What to speak then of the reciprocation with those who have true devotion to him? So this is actually an excerpt from Vishnu Purana, where Maitreya Rishi is asking a question and he is getting answers. And the whole thing is explained by Parashurmuni, where he describes actually Krishna is the supreme, and he enchants everyone, and everyone gets liberated. It's only Krishna who gives everybody liberation. Doesn't matter who you are, what condition, he's just going to liberate everybody. So actually there are many references for how Krishna is just not an incarnation, and he is Swayam Bhagavan from Bhagavatam also. And also, he is also the source of Narayana, and he is also the source of all the Vishnus. There is also references for that. Just like 10.85.31, Prayers of Devaki, Canto 10, Bhagavatam, Chapter 85, Verse 31, Prayers of Devaki. The chapter itself is titled, Lord Krishna instructs Vasudev and retrieves Vasudeva and retrieves Devaki's son. So that is the chapter. There, if you see, Devaki is actually praying to him. She's saying, O soul of all that be, the creation, maintenance, and destruction of the universe are all carried out by a fraction of an expansion of an expansion of your expansion. So today I have come to take shelter of you, O Supreme Lord. Now Sridhara Swami explains this verse as follows. The Lord of Vaikuntha, Narayana, is but an expansion of Sri Krishna. Mahavishnu is the first creator, is Lord Narayana's expansion. The total material energy emanates from Mahavishnu's glands. And of that total material energy, the three modes of nature are divided portions. Thus, it is Sri Krishna acting through the expansions who generates, sustains, and dissolves the universe. So basically, this verse talks about how Krishna is the source of Narayan as well as the source of the three Vishnus. Again, Bhagavatam 10.14.14, Canto 10, Chapter 14, Verse 14. This is a verse by Brahma. Are you not the original Narayana, O Supreme Controller? Since you are the soul of every embodied being and the eternal witness of all created realms. Indeed, Lord Narayana is your expansion, and he is called Narayana because he is the generating source of the primeval water of the universe. He is real, not a product of your illusory Maya. So Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan. That's why the phrase says Krishna Sambhavat. And Sri Krishna Chaitanya is also Krishna Sambhavat, non-different from Krishna. So I'll stop here. If you have any questions, comments, additions, or corrections, please go ahead. Hare Krishna.
I wish my lessons nobody. I'll go first, my time today. What are you? So amazing class, mother, today. Like, so nice, mother, today. Thank you so much for the class. especially when you were talking about the stage of Prema Bhakti, right? How the devotees see everything in a material world, which seems to be like awkward, but in the spiritual platform, how much they feel Krishna, all those things, it's so, so nice, Mataji. I mean, it's a good feel about this class. You did a lot of research, Mataji. There's so much information. So nice, Mataji. Thank you so much. I really like love this class, Mataji. I want to hear again and again. One more thing I noticed is today's, the voice is so commanding, Mataji, because when you were talking about the essence of Krishna, right, Mataji, how he reciprocates. Your voice is so commanding that added extra value. That's so exciting, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. Jai Haribol. Thank you, Prabhu.
One more thing, Mataji, like I was reading the Prapada Vedamata, I was telling you, right, Mataji, third volume. There, I mean, today only coincidentally, Prapada was shifted to San Francisco, Mataji, after he was very sick. So there, he was given one room, I mean, they took a 9-bedroom house around the San Francisco Bay Area. So there, they put all the pictures of Krishna and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, everything. So devotees were serving him. So he got only two Prabhus with him at that time. Ketnananda and forget other name, Mataji. Those two Prabhus were serving him. So Prabhupada asked him to make a round. They were in a big living room. They will be making rounds, just like that. Prabhupada will be chanting. They just had to follow him. So whenever he see the picture of Krishna, he just look at the lotus feet of Krishna, and he just cry. And then he'll start running, start walking. So like that, those two devotees, they get so tired. They said, then they ask Prabhupada, I mean, the Prabhupada asked them, so are you tired? They say, Prabhupada, we have been walking, making this round for 1 hour, so far. So he said, he laughs, and he'll never keep on walking.
Wow. Nice.
So many things. Yeah, there's so many things, Mata. I mean, especially the third book, so, so nice, Mata. So, like this, the comment I did, Mata, when somebody believes in the God, or somebody believes in the subject, comment, I mean, automatically it appears, Mata. I mean, you don't have to artificially add anything.
It
happens.
Yeah, very true, very true. Nice, Prabhu.
Yeah, that's right, Mata. I don't have any questions, Mata. Thank you so much, Mata.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hi, Bol Mataji. Thank you so much for the wonderful class, Mataji.
Hare Bol Devati.
Refreshing, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Mataji. You had like so much references and it's really amazing, Mataji.
Yeah.
So, like so much indebted to you for it anyway.
No, Mataji. No, Mataji, the subject is very nice, Mataji. It's a very high-level topic, and it's so nice that our acharyas have given such nice, seminars, and they've written such beautiful books, so it's so beautiful to understand these things.
Thank you,
Mataji.
I don't have any questions, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Revati. Okay. Then we'll end the call. So I think Rishman Prabhu had to drop off. So we'll end the call.
Sure, Mataji.
Vancha kalpataru vyascha kripasya
vancha evacha padikanu pavanepyo vaishnavyo
namo
namaha divashna vrandha hare chakur ke jaya shri shri brahma sam ke jaya all glories to the assembled devotees. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare
Krishna. Hare bol.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you, Prabhu. Haribol.
Thank you, Mataji. And I want to